Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for a nice presentation. So, as you probably all know, proteins among macronutrients are known to be more satiating than carbohydrates and fats. And so the high protein diets are used for the aim to decrease body weight, and it is effective, at least transiently, for that purpose. However, there's presently no definition of the maximal amount of dietary protein with no side effects, even if we know that high protein diets are contraindicated in individuals with chronic kidney diseases or risk of chronic kidney diseases. So in the general context, the aim of our intervention in the MindYouGut project was to know what is the balance between the advantages of weight loss and metabolic health associated with weight loss and the impact on the gut ecosystem. So this cartoon just shows you that a part of dietary endogenous protein are not digested or not fully digested. And as a matter of fact, there is between 6 and 12 grams of proteins that move from the small intestine to the large intestine, where they meet the microbiota, proteases, and peptidases, which release amino acids from them. And since these amino acids cannot be absorbed through the colonic epithelium, in contrast with the small intestine, they are metabolized by the microbiota, which use them for their own protein synthesis, but also release numerous bacterial metabolites, which can be either released in the portal circulation and have effect on the periphery, or can be excreted in the feces. So more precisely, you can see here that the microbiota release a numerous amount of bacterial metabolites for amino acids. Just to show you some examples, glutamate is a precursor for butyrate, so it's called short-chain fatty acids, although it is well known that undigestible polysaccharides are the main source of a short-chain fatty acid. Amino acids are specific precursor of branch-chain amino acids, this is an indicator of protein consumption. But they can also release gas like hydrogen sulfide from cysteine, several aromatic compounds like phenols, indoles, polyamines, ammonium, etc., etc. And this is very important to know what these bacterial metabolize, especially when the concentration change within the luminal environment as on energy metabolism, either positively or negatively. Do these bacterial metabolites have genotoxic or cytotoxic effect when they present in excess? Can they affect the epithelial renewal, which is fast? And can they affect barrier function and be involved in inflammation? So what experimental strategy did we use in the MindYouGut project? We go from the most simple, which was in vitro test of bacterial metabolites on the human colonic epithelial cell or rat colonocytes. A bit more complicated was a test in animal model of the bacterial metabolites that are suspected to be active. And for this, we did a new kind of experiment, which is intracolonic instillation in anesthetized rodents. And as you can see on the bottom of this slide, we inserted a catheter in the colon and we perfused for 1 hour with specific bacterial metabolites, and then we recovered the colonocytes and look at the characteristics of these colonocytes. More complicated was a nutritional intervention in animal models and the impact on the colorectal mucosa, which was used as a proof of concept to go to very complicated and more expensive nutritional intervention study in randomized double-blind clinical parallel trials against placebo in volunteers and see the impact on the gut ecosystem. So this cartoon just shows you that the bacterial metabolites can either diffuse or be transported within the colony, within the colonocytes, where they can be further metabolized, then giving rise to co-metabolites, which means bacterial metabolites transformed by the host. And I'm going to show you today that some bacterial metabolites and co-metabolites can have an impact on colonocyte metabolism and function. And then metabolites and co-metabolites can be released in the bloodstream, the part which is not metabolized. So this is just to show you that pecrisol, which is a bacterial metabolite produced by the microbiota from tyrosine, can increase the DNA damage in human colonocytes, and as you can see here, from 1 millimolar to 3 millimolar, which is physiological concentration of P-crystal, which can be found within the mammal intestinal lumen, there is a dose-dependent increase of the genotoxicity and DNA damage as measured by the gamma H2AX test, which is the golden standard for this kind of assay. So from these experiments, we published 2 years ago a paper in which we proposed that P-crystal in excess is a genotoxic agent for colonocytes. We tested also, and I'm going to show you this as an example, the effect of hydrogen sulfide on a colonocyte's metabolism. And as you can see in the left part of this slide, when you incubated human colonocytes or rat colonocytes with low concentration of hydrogen sulfide, that is 20 and 40 micromolar, you can see that there is a marked increase in the oxygen consumption by the colonocyte, but at higher concentration, there is a marked inhibitory effect, which is very rapid, which can be detected within 1 minute. And by performing the installation, intracolonic installation of hydrogen sulfide in a form of sodium hydrogen sulfide, which is a rapid donor of hydrogen sulfide, you can see that it can dose-dependently increase the expression of genes related to the inflammatory process, that is a nitric oxide synthase inducible form, which is clearly associated with inflammation, interleukin 6 and interleukin 1 beta. So from this, we published 2 years ago one paper in which we proposed that hydrogen sulfide is an oxidative substrate, and this oxidation is responsible for the detoxification of this compound, and can be a metabolic troublemaker when it is used at a higher concentration, and thus it depends clearly on the concentration within the intestinal lumen. Then we move to a little bit more complicated experiments by giving to rats high protein diets for 2 weeks, and a control group received normal protein diets, isocaloric. And then we isolated the colonocytes at the end of these 2 weeks, and we saw the expression of genes, and we saw that there is a clear decrease of genes related to cellular metabolism, intracellular signaling, DNA repair, glutathione metabolism, cellular adhesion, while other genes related to cell proliferation and chemical barrier function was clearly upregulating. However, this high-protein diet displayed no genotoxic effect on colonocytes and altered neither the colonic epithelial renewal or colonic barrier integrity, and then we proposed in a paper published last year that the transcriptional regulation observed after high-protein diet might result from an adaptive process. Then we move to the human intervention study with high protein diet. So we recruited 38 individuals which were overweight, because that's the kind of person which are likely to use high protein diet for losing weight. It was female and male participants between 18 and 40 years old of age, with a body mass index between 25 and 30. And with a stable body within the last 3 months, and we excluded, of course, a person with kidney disease or at risk for kidney disease or liver disease, gastrointestinal disease, which use antibiotic, prebiotic or probiotic, were intolerant to the dietary supplements used, or which were smokers. And actually, as Yolanda said this morning, we used two sources of protein, an animal source in the form of milk protein isolate, which was mainly casein, and a plant source, which was isolated soya protein. And the rationale of this experiments was that they have different digestibility. Usually plant protein are less digestible than animal protein. And they are different amino acid composition, would mean that probably the metabolites released by the microbiota will be different. That was our working hypothesis. So as you can see here, there was two periods, a normalization period of 2 weeks in which the volunteers received the habitual energy intake, and they received recommendation so that 15% of their energy was present as protein in the diet, 50% as carbohydrate, and 35% as lipids. And then we randomized into three groups. The first group, the high protein casein diet. In that case, they receive a supplement in the form of 15% casein, pure casein. So in that case, we reduce the carbohydrates to have isocaloric diet, and we maintain the lipids. The high protein soy diet was exactly the same, except that in that case, they receive a supplement in the form of 15% pure soya protein. And the control group was a normal proteic diet, which received, of course, the usual, the usual amount of protein. And in that case, we give this, but they don't know since it was double blind, 50% maltodextrin as supplement to maintain a 50% of energy provided by carbohydrates. And every week during the nutritional intervention period, we work over the feces, urine, and blood for metabolomic study by proton RMN. And just before and after the nutritional intervention, the clinician recovered the rectal biopsies for doing gene expression by microarrays. So, first of all, when you measure the urea concentration in the blood, the uremia, you can see that the volunteers which receive casein and soya protein has a marked increase in their uremia, which means that we have good compliance of participants, which is the main point, of course. When we compare the intake of dietary fibers, it was almost similar. Also very important to avoid the confusing factors. And they also had non-significant difference between their energy consumption. So by looking at the metabolic parameters measured in the groups every week during the 3 weeks intervention trial, we saw no effect on the waist circumference, no effect on the cholesterol, LDL, HDL, triglyceride, and no effect on glycemia, insulinemia, but in contrast, we saw a marked and significant effect of the soya protein in the soya protein group, and it was measured every week for the systolic blood pressure, which was significantly lowered. So we measured in the soya protein the content of isoflavones, and actually we found that it contains isoflavones. So we don't know what is due to the soy protein or to the isoflavone contained within the soy protein extract. So this cartoon just make a recapitulation on the metabolomic data. And first of all, we saw that both high protein diets in the form of casein or soya protein decreases the fecal butyrate concentration, which is a priori unfavorable, since butyrate is well known as an energy substrate for colonocytes and as the main regulator for gene expression in colonocytes. We saw that both protein increases urea, isobutyrate, phenylacetylglutamine, andoxyl sulfate. And andoxyl sulfate is a co-metabolite, which is well known as a uremic toxin, so it's also unfavorable, at least in individual at risk for kidney diseases. And for casein, in addition, we saw an increase of picrisol, and I told you this before that picrisol is a genotoxic for colonocytes, so it's also probably unfavorable, and picrisyl sulfate, which is another uremic toxin toward the kidney. Then we move to the fecal water cytotoxic test, and we saw actually no effect of the fecal water recovered for individuals receiving the high-protein diet on the human colonocyte cytotoxicity. However, we find an interesting result showing that the most cytotoxic fecal water samples are the highest content in hydroxyphenylacetate, bile acids, ethanol, and 5-aminovalerate. We tested 5-aminovalerate on human colonocyte. We saw no cytotoxic effect, which means that by itself, it's not cytotoxic, at least in vitro. Bile acids and ethanol are well known to be cytotoxic compounds toward mammalian cells. But we tested hydroxyphenylacetate since we had no a lot of data on the effect of these bacterial metabolites. And this is just to show you that contrary to the working hypothesis, we found no cytotoxic effect of these metabolites on the human colonocytes. In contrast, we saw that these metabolites can increase the production of reactive oxygen species in colonocytes and can decrease oxygen consumption, so acting like some kind of metabolic troublemaker toward colonocytes. And interestingly, it was found as a genotoxic compound, since it can increase DNA alteration in human colonocytes. And it's a paper that is actually in revision in Biochemica, Biophysica, ACTA. By measuring the diet and fecal and adherent microbiota composition, we saw that there was no significant effect of the nutritional intervention on the fecal and adherent rectal biopsies microbiota, which led us to propose in a paper published last year that in our study, the availability of substrate is likely a central element for determining the urinary metabolite concentration. We found by transcriptional analysis that casein diet and soya diet were able to modify gene expression related to epithelial homeostasis, with a specific effect of casein and soya protein, and also effect common to both protein, for example, on cell proliferation and cell cycle, cell apoptosis, and cytoskeleton formation. However, we found no sign of inflammation in the rectal biopsies by measuring pro-inflammatory cytokines in biopsies and fecal calprotectin and secretory immunoglobulin A, which means a high protein diet by itself does not induce, at least in this experimental condition, any sign of epithelial inflammation. So to conclude from this study, we propose that the high protein diet display an impact on the colorectal epithelium liminal environment that appears rather unfavorable. We made a review paper last year on that topic, and that the changes observed coincide with numerous modification of expression of genes related to the homeostasis of the rectal mucosa without, however, any sign of inflammation. Then we published this year a review paper, position paper, in the name of the Manu Gerd group. We said that although high protein diet appear efficient for weight loss, the effect of these diets on microbiota-derived metabolites and gene expression in the gut raised new questions on the impact of high-protein diets on the large intestine mucosa homeostasis, leading the authors to recommend some caution regarding the utilization of high-protein diet, notably in a recurrent and or long-term ways. And this is just this slide to present my warm acknowledgement to my colleagues at INRA, notably Martin Beaumont, a PhD thesis student, which did a lot of work presented today. My colleagues from Valencia, from Cochin Institute for the Transcriptomic Analysis, our colleagues in INRA Toulouse, who help us in the fecal water test, the clinician from the Avicenne Hospital in France, the University of Reading, Sandrine Close, and colleagues in the University of Reading, And lastly, Gerard Libisch for metabolomic analysis of lipids. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your talk. Very interesting. I think we can allow one question. Gareth.
This is just a question out of personal curiosity. I know you looked at casein and milk and soy proteins. Would you have any view as to how this is likely to generalize to people eating high protein diets based on meat or fish or eggs, for instance, which are more likely
okay,
natural?
Regarding meat proteins, it's not only a matter of protein, but also a matter of hemoglobin and fat. So we tested the pure protein just to avoid to have confusing and difficult interpretation. So actually, I think that each protein should give a specific imprint of bacterial metabolites, because there's not two proteins which have the same amino acid composition. So I think we have to study.
Thank you. I think we have to continue. Thank you very much again.